Hello all, good morning. Trevor's Dampier, Trevor's Dampier Ministries, a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. Today is Friday, August 12th, and we are making our way now into the Sabbath today at the closing day of Tu B'Av. So very serious day, still high watch day, high rapture, high event watch day as we go into the Sabbath today, which even makes it a more dangerous day. Now, definitely expect some big events to happen, and very well, once again, could be the invasion of Taiwan that we're looking for before everything goes dark. Now, if we go into the Torah reading today, this is Parashah Va'etchanan. Parashah Va'etchanan, and it means, and I pleaded. This takes us to Deuteronomy 3, 23 through 7. So let's go to Deuteronomy 3. And we'll start from 23. Let's go take a look. I'll actually go to the whole part so we can see. I mean, to the beginning so we can see what was taking place. And what was taking place here, the land east of the Jordan was divided. And this land, which we possessed at that time from Arur, which is by the river Arnon and half the mountains of Gilead and its cities, I gave to the Reubenites and the Gadites. The rest of Gilead and all Bashan, the kingdom of Og, I gave to half the tribe of Manasseh. All the region of Argob with all Bashan was called the land of the giants. Jair, the son of Manasseh, took all the region of Argob as far as the border of Geshurites and the Mashatites, and called Bashan after his own name, Havoth Jair, to this day. Also, I gave Gilead to Machir, and to the Reubenites and the Gadites I gave from Gilead as far as the river Arnon, the middle of the river, as the border, as far as the river Jabbok, the border of the people of Ammon, the plain also, with the Jordan as the border from Chinnereth as far as the east side of the sea of the Arabah, the salt sea, below the slopes of Pisgah. Verse 18. Then I commanded you at that time, saying, the Lord your God has given you this land to possess. All you men of valor shall cross over armed before your brethren, the children of Israel. But your wives, your little ones, and your livestock shall stay in your cities, which I have given you, until the Lord has given rest to your brethren as to you, and they also possess the land which the Lord your God has given them beyond the Jordan. Then each of you may return to his possession, which I have given you. So this is, remember we had read last Sabbath, and this is Moses just basically going over everything that has happened, all of the blessings, or I should say but their life story of deliverance. And this is what we have to remind ourselves as we stand and wait and watch, and then you are in anticipation and you're like, oh man, you know, how come we didn't go yet? But you got to remind yourself of God's faithfulness. It is very important. It keeps that seed of faith growing, you know what I mean, within you. And that's what the Lord continues to do in the Bible. He does that, but he wants us to remember these things as well, so you will not turn away from him. 21, and I commanded Joshua at that time, saying, your eyes have seen all that the Lord your God has done to these two kings. So will the Lord do to all the kingdoms through which you pass. You must not fear them, for the Lord your God himself fights for you. Moses is forbidden to enter the land. Then I pleaded with the Lord at that time, saying, O Lord God, you have begun to show your servant your greatness and your mighty hand. For what God is there in heaven or on earth who can do anything like your works and your mighty deeds? I pray, let me cross over and see the good land beyond the Jordan, those pleasant mountains and Lebanon. But the Lord was angry with me on your account and would not listen to me. So the Lord said to me, enough of that. Speak no more to me of this matter. Go up to the top of Pisgah and lift up your eyes toward the west, the north, the south, and the east. Behold it with your eyes, for you shall not cross over this Jordan, but command Joshua and encourage him and strengthen him, for he shall go over this people, and he shall cause them to inherit the land which you will see. So we stayed in the valley opposite Beth Peor. Now, while it seems like this is a sad story, while we're reading it today, this could be more of a symbolic story of some of them that, you could just say Moses, but Moses would represent those that carried the church for a certain period of time and were not going to stay. But they, it was their time to leave and then hand it off to the next generation. That is what we are doing as watchmen and servants of the Most High God right now. We are the first stage of warning right now. And then we would be the Moseses. I mean, he's not angry with us, but we would be the Moseses that get taken right now. And then the handoff over to Joshua or the left behind Christians that are going to wake up, and then they will carry the torch. And it's their turn now. So that is literally where we are at. We are at an aggressive time in history. And then even tomorrow, once it hits tomorrow, because today is the 16th of Av, once it hits noon, and then it goes into noon on Saturday, then that would bring us to the 17th of Av. And this is where 67 Jews were killed in the Hebron massacre. So even that is another episode of something that happened during this time that they look at as a major tragedy, and that will take us all the way to Sunday. So that's why I've been saying we will watch for high events all this weekend, and today is a very, very serious day, because usually on the closing days, that's when these major events happen, and this is the last super moon before we get to September. And in Dana Coverstone's dream, he said everything went dark in September. We already watched the first part come to pass, so we're just watching for the second part of it to come to pass. Okay, so let's get to the news. China. The U.S. will suffer a crushing defeat in Taiwan. The end of its hegemony is near. Issued white paper of reunification. So the United States has learned no lessons from its failed line in Ukraine and is trying to do the same in Taiwan. Washington will suffer a crushing defeat here, Chinese ambassador to Russia Zhang Hanwei said in an exclusive interview with TASS. We are on the road to our nation's most important goal, the reunification of the homeland. The Chinese people have unshakable will, strong determination, full confidence in every opportunity to defend national sovereignty and national dignity, the Chinese diplomat stressed. Instead of learning a lesson from their failed line on the Ukraine issue, the United States has artificially linked it to the Taiwan issue. Here, they are in for an even bigger crushing defeat. The end of their reign. Zhang Hanhui pointed out that as many facts prove, the United States is the real destroyer of international norms and world order, a source of increasing instability and uncertainty in today's world. U.S. hegemony has become the biggest challenge to the progress and peaceful development of human civilization, he added. China firmly opposes the following wrong actions of the U.S. hegemony and intimidation. The countdown to Taiwan's reunification with China has begun. The announcement by the People's Liberation Army that the sea and air exercises around Taiwan are continuing came to underline that it was not a symbolic gesture, but the actual initiation of steps for reunification with China. Excuse me. White paper from Beijing on Taiwan. The Taiwan Affairs Bureau, an agency of the Chinese government, released a white paper on August 10th detailing how Beijing plans to retake the island mainly through economic incentives. We are willing to create a vast space of cooperation to achieve peaceful reunification, the Beijing document said, but we will leave no room for separatist actions aimed at the pseudo-independence of Taiwan in any form. So things are getting serious over there. They're even creating documents relating how they're going to do the reunification. So probably they can send it to Taiwanese government officials as well. So things are definitely getting serious indeed. Let's hear Sky News regarding these documents.
Chow Kian. He's threatened a re-education process for Taiwan's 23 million people, saying Beijing will never allow Taiwan independence after China ended its live-fire military exercises in the Taiwan Strait for now.
I'd rather not use the word invasion when we talk about China and Taiwan. It's not an independent state. Taiwan is a province of the People's Republic of China. When compelled, we are ready to use all necessary means. As to what does it mean by all necessary means, you can use your imagination. We will never allow Taiwan to be separated from China.
Yeah, using our imagination, hey? China's Taiwan Affairs Office released a policy document committing to using force against Taiwan if it couldn't control the island by peaceful means. In the rare address here, Ambassador Chow also insisted Australia and China can be friends despite increasing instability in the region. Shadow Home Affairs Minister Karen Andrews says the ambassador's address in Canberra was concerning and that Australia can't be bullied by another country.
We do rely very heavily on our trading relationship with China, and whilst it has clearly had some irritants in the past, we will all be better off with a good, strong relationship into the future. But it can't be a one-sided relationship. It can't be China telling Australia what to do, serving up a list of demands and expecting Australia to cave in.
And the good news is that so far, of course, the Albanese Labor government has shown no signs of doing that. It's been very firm and calm on these issues.
Yep. So you hear Australia getting concerned about what China is doing with Taiwan. And Australia is one of the ones that are going to get struck as well. I showed you guys a prophetic word probably about a couple months back. But New Zealand and Australia are also going to get struck in this war, in this world war. And that very well could come once they invade Taiwan or once they finish off America. We don't really know the timing of that one, but it is told that it is going to happen. Let's continue. Over 100 French municipalities still without drinking water. So Europe is suffering a historic drought, and July was one of the warmest on record, according to the UN, as nearly 60% of Europe experiences a historic drought. More than 100 French municipalities are still without access to drinking water, according to the French Ecological Transition Minister, Christophe Bichu. There is nothing left in the pipes, Bichu was quoted as saying by Euronews during a visit to the town of Ramelles late last week, adding that over 100 municipalities in France can now only rely on supplies that are being delivered by trucks. Amazing. So the famine is here. We know the four beasts are released and the seals are open. We are watching these things happen. Famine is coming. It is growing aggressively, and it's not going to stop. It is not going to be reversed. Let's hear BP Earthwatch share Weon's video on this.
Final story is about climate change. Scientists have tried explaining it for years. They've given lectures, they've published papers, but none of it has really moved our world leaders. Maybe pictures will. Take a look at the first set. It may look like a desert, but it's not. What you're looking at is a reservoir in Spain. 84% empty. You can see the paddle boats and water slides abandoned nearby. Aquatic life driven to death. The reason? Climate change. Spain had its hottest July since 1961. Some parts of the Iberian Peninsula are at their driest in 1200 years. Let that sink in. 1200 years. Now for the next set of pictures. What you're looking at is Italy's longest river, River Po. Large sandbanks have started appearing around it. Why? Again, climate change. This region is facing its worst drought in 70 years. As the river pulled back, it revealed some ghosts of the past, like this one, a bomb from World War II. The device was found by fishermen in the region. They called in the army, which carried out a controlled explosion. Now we go to France. See those beautiful sand plains? What if I told you those are not plains? What you're looking at is a dried up river. Not a single drop of water remains. All the tourist boats have been beached as a result. The restaurants nearby have nearly shut. The reason? Our next set of pictures will give you an idea. Wildfires are raging across southwestern France. Nearly 6,000 hectares of forests have been burnt. This blaze follows two wildfires in the month of July. Put together, they scorched more than 20,000 hectares. What do these pictures tell you? A crisis of biblical proportions. You've seen the pictures, now let me show you the data. 63% of land in Britain and Europe is facing drought. 63%. That's almost the size of India. 46% of the land is under warning. 17% under a state of alert. It's a perfect climate storm. The rains have reduced to a trickle. The temperatures have hit multi-decade highs. As a result, Europe's rivers are drying. The reservoirs barely have any water left. And the situation is the same across the continent. Southern England had its driest July since 1836. Overall, it was Britain's driest July in 20 years. The government has declared amber alert for the next 4 days. Temperatures are so high, it could trigger fires. In France, they already have. It was their driest July since records began in 1959. Three countries breached 40 degrees Celsius last month: Spain, France, and the UK. Now remember, we're talking about Europe. Their summers are supposed to be pleasant and cheery. It's supposed to be the travel season. Instead, Europe is literally baking.
We haven't analyzed fully the event because it is still ongoing. But based on my experience, I think that this is perhaps even more extreme than the 2018. Just to give you an idea, the 2018 drought was so extreme that looking back at the at least at the last 500 years, there were no other events similar to the drought of 2018. But this year, I think it is really worse than the 2018.
This drought has serious economic consequences. You see, rivers in Europe are not just vital ecosystems, they're transport routes. They carry around 1 ton of freight per citizen every year. Total value, more than $80 billion, 80. But right now, those rivers look like this. Those are the mighty rivers of Europe, now reduced to dried sand beds. Without their water, Europe cannot grow food, it cannot transport cargo, it cannot even generate electricity. Western Europe's hydropower output was down 20% in the second quarter of this year. How is Europe planning to tackle this crisis? Each government has announced its own measures. France, for instance, has set up a crisis team. Their main priority is ensuring drinking water. Reports say 100 French municipalities are short of drinking water. Italy has declared a drought emergency. Water rationing has been announced in cities like Verona and Pisa. Rice production has been hit. Farmers are unable to produce enough rice for the famous Italian risotto. The Netherlands has declared a nationwide water shortage. People have been asked to take quicker showers, also not to wash their cars or water their gardens. In Germany, all the focus is on the Rhine. It is the financial heartbeat of Germany. You see, the Rhine requires a basic water level to support shipping. If it falls below that, ships cannot pass. Germany says it is days away from falling below that level. Freight ships are already sailing at 25% capacity. If this is not an emergency, I don't know what is. The pictures, the data, the testimonies, all of them hint at a climate emergency in Europe. It is not some distant threat anymore. It is very much here. And as we prepare to enter the winter season, more questions remain. Yes, the heat will disappear, but what climatic shock will winter behold? Neon is now available in your country.
Yep. So looks like the EU is the one that is going to get hit first. They've already reduced their gas by a treaty for 15%. Less usage, and they don't even have enough energy to really fulfill all their needs already. And they're saying cut an additional 15% from what you barely have, you know. And now these famines of water that are occurring is going to cause major famine with grain. You heard the rice issue, their transport issues. You got the turbine issue with Russia. So it looks like the New World Order, outside of God's judgments that is causing these famines, which they are helping with, you know what I mean, by the way. But other than that, it looks like a lot of other things is going to be like a domino effect of what is happening here. So very, very serious times that are coming this winter, if we could even make it there. But we also still have the war stuff that is coming as well. So kickoff is definitely here, and we are waiting and watching for the next layer of it, which is going to be China invading Taiwan. Let's continue. Explosions also at an airbase in Belarus. Russian aircraft were parked, what the authorities of the country claim. So in the area of the military airport Zyabrovka of Belarus, which is located in the Gomel region near the border with Ukraine, during the night explosions were heard and flashes were visible, the telegram channel Belarusian Gayan reported. The channel in question, which monitors the war, reported that there were at least 8 flashes. A reader of the website, Zerkala, reported that shortly after midnight, he heard 5 loud bangs and the shock wave was felt in the city of Gomel. Another reader who was downtown reported not noticing anything unusual. A Flagstock website reader reported that explosions were heard from 0025 to 0032, so 1225 at night, 1232. The shockwave was felt and twice some bright flashes were seen through the thick cloud cover. Now, here goes a tweet regarding it. Let you see that and then I'll read it to you. As 8 large explosions reported from Zyabrovka airfield near Hamel in Belarus. Lots of Russian military gear is stationed there, and the Russians often launch attack against Ukraine from Zyabrovka. Ukraine might have counterattacked Belarusian territory for the first time. So we just heard, what was it, yesterday, the day before yesterday, a Russian aircraft air military base was struck. And then Russia denied that it was Ukraine that did it. And now the next day, you got an aircraft area in Belarus to get struck. And this is where Russians often launch attacks from here. So this is definitely Ukraine has used HIMARS in order to strike Russia. And it is obvious. So we just stand, wait, and continue to watch to see what is going to happen with Russia's retaliatory measures against this, which, once again, we are standing at a very dangerous time and could very well happen today or this weekend. So we will watch for it. Let's continue. Consequences, cause and effect. So Pastor Jerry Tony shares a word regarding the separation of the sheep and the goats, even in your own household. It is our job to stand firm in Christ and not let anyone steal our crown. 2 will be left in the bed, 1 taken, the other one left. We are at the end. Hold fast, for our redemption draws near. Let's hear him out on this.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We glorify your name. We thank you, Lord. Thank you for your amazing grace. Your amazing grace. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you for your grace. Consequences, cause and effect. Cause and effect. Let me have just a minute here to do a little housekeeping before I get started on this message. I want to remind you that we're having the gathering here at Church at the Ranch, September the 26th through the 28th. We will be having church services on the 26th, a couple of services. The church will be open for people to fellowship and to have maybe bring some guitars and play some music or do whatever. I think you'll enjoy the time. So we'll be preaching at least 2 services on the 26th and 27th. And according to the Maseroth Feast of Trumpets is on the 28th. So we will be doing a morning service to conclude that event. The RV park is open, and we have three cabins that will be available, and they are finished, and we are in the final stages of finishing up the laundromat. If you know somebody that knows how to tape and bed sheetrock, the building is sheetrocked and needs taped and bedded so we can get it painted and finish that project up. So if you know anybody knows how to do that, we would appreciate it. Very much so. Amen. Thank you, by the way, for subscribing to this YouTube channel, and I appreciate that also. Consequences, cause and effect, cause and effect. We're in the very last days, and many are turning from the faith, literally turning from the faith. All of these turning from the faith bring consequences that affect us. We're affected emotionally and even physically by the consequences of the actions of others. It is possible for us to even get sidetracked by the actions of others in our lives who have turned from the faith. We are to be wise and let no man take our crown. What I'm going to attempt to do today is give you a little bit of wisdom on how to handle a situation like this according to the Word of God. It's going to sound like a tough word, but you know what? It is the Word, and it is a prophetic word, so let's stay with the Word. Luke 12, starting at verse 51. Suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth? I tell you, nay, but rather division. For from henceforth there shall be five in one house divided, and two against three, three against two, and two against three. The father shall be divided against the son, and the son against the father, and the mother against the daughter, and the daughter against her mother, and the mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. We need to learn to let this division take place. It is of God. Yeah. God is the one causing the division. When God moves someone out of your life, let it happen. Let the division take place. This division is prophetic and is sure to take place. Family are being cruel in these last days. Many who are standing on the word are losing contact with children, grandchildren. I even see divorces taking place because one person has taken the mark of the beast and argues that it's not. But arguments and division are taking place in the household like never before. Grandchildren are being taken away from grandparents. Children are being divided to one parent to another. And we're seeing isolation take place in many people's lives. I know several people who are now divided from their family because they're standing on the word, not taking the mark of the beast. The flock is being thinned. Quite frankly, that's the truth. There's a separation of the wheat and the tares taking place, the sheep and the goats. It's taking place. Friends are coming against friends. Yes, division will even take place and include with those friends that you have and even those you least expect. Many are making decisions around you that they, I emphasize the word, that they are responsible for. You are not responsible for their actions, even if they affect you. However, you're also going to have to take action because of the actions of others. Let the division take place. Cause and effect. You may have to separate yourself from friends and family to keep your spiritual sanity, to stay enduring to the end, to stay focused on the things of God. Keep in mind that it is they who are causing the division by their actions, unbelief, and iniquity, not you. When you move away from their decision to come against you, they'll blame you and attack you and say it is you. They always will, because I believe a lot of them are accompanied with a Jezebel spirit. You may be called toxic and religious, but stay your course. Cause and effect. They'll use gossip and lies and deception and try to destroy you. They do not care what the word says. You can quote scripture all day long, and they will not adhere to the word. Christians will receive false accusations against you. Yeah, it's true. They'll receive gossip that's laced with lies. There is cause and effect. Let me give you a few examples of cause and effect. Moses brought down the Ten Commandments, and because of the actions of the Hebrew people, he broke the tablets because they broke the commandments. When you have people in your life that continue in sin and iniquity, you'll have to move away from them. To put yourself into a sanctuary where you can have peace in God. For some people, that's moving out of the house and moving and staying alone, but they're enduring to the end. Cause and effect. Let me give you a what if. Concerning things of your ministry, what if the sons of Noah rebelled against Noah's God-given design of the ark and wanted to do it their way? The ark would have never been built. Cause and effect. Judas betrayed Jesus and suffered the consequences of his actions. Cause and effect. But this goes both ways. Look at what happened when the thief on the cross, when he repented, Jesus forgave him. But he did repent. Many people don't understand that, but he did. Cause and effect. His result was the kingdom. Amen? We have people today who hate you because you understand the Word of God and will not budge from your position in the Word of God. They'll hate the vision God has given you, and they will even try to destroy it or take it over. This is a Jezebel spirit. Let's talk for a minute before I close about compromisers. We have those who will not stand on the Word because of what others think. Let me make myself clear. There are people in these last days who know the Word, but won't stand on the word because of what others think. They will compromise everything they have to keep relationships that others have already destroyed by their actions. I see Christians begging their families to stand together when in truth the only way that is going to happen is if the Christian in that family compromises. The only way that kind of family can stay together that's mixed with non-Christians and Christians is if the Christian compromises. That Christian then is in danger of becoming lukewarm. Satan's side, I'm going to tell you the truth, you better hear me clearly, will never compromise. Their goal is to destroy your faith. They'll use fear. They'll use threat, they'll use gossip, they'll use compromise, they'll do anything they can to get you to walk away from your stand for Jesus Christ. So the compromise does more damage to the Christian than the non-Christian. Fear is the motivation for the compromiser. They have a fear of loss of family and friends. Listen to this verse of scripture in Luke 14:26. If any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. So whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. The word hate in this verse of scripture means to love less or to detest. I'll put it to you this way. Love your family and friends less, a lot less, than you love Christ. I think the word hate pushes it down to a level where no matter who comes against the Jesus Christ in your life, detest that. Come against it. Your cross is for you to slay your flesh upon and count everything but loss for Jesus Christ. Even family and friends, if necessary. In conclusion, I got a little short word about naysayers, and then I'll close this. Avoid the naysayers, even if it is family and friends. If you do not make a firm stand in the word, the naysayers will affect your calling. Do not listen to the naysayers. They are those who will say things negative about everything you know about the word of God. Amen? Naysayers will try to direct you other than where God is leading you. A naysayer will listen to gossip and try to destroy you. A naysayer will try to take over your ministry and redirect what God has called you to do. They would redesign the ark. Stand firm in these last days, because everything has cause and effect. Even this verse of scripture, which is the mainstay for this ministry. Titus chapter 2, 11 and 12. For the grace of God has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present day. I pray that the grace of God that you are following is a trueness of God's grace and is teaching you to walk daily, to walk away from iniquity and sin. Oh, by the way, I think they call that repentance. This is Jerry Tony. Love you guys. Have a blessed day. Talk to you later. Bye.
Amen. And we have never seen that scripture of family being separated, mother against daughter-in-law against mother-in-law, until now. With the mark of the beast, this brought this scripture to life. Like, we used to think, when we used to hear that scripture in the church, it was just because we were Christians. And it did affect many of our relationships, just being a Christian. I lost many. The Lord has been stripping people my whole life away from me since I came into Christianity. And it got to the point, really, that there was really nobody around. And what the Lord also did with me was separate me from relationships in the church, because I was kind of in the middle lane, you know. But now, later on in my life, now I understand why I couldn't fit in into the world, and I couldn't fit in really inside the church with the church members. While they were, most of them, pretending to be holy, I didn't fit in with them because I was dirty but yet clean. They seemed too clean to me. And I was like, well, I came from the streets. Like, I came from a realm where I can't really talk to you about my testimony, because I feel like you've had it good your whole life, even though they probably hadn't, but that's what they presented to me. You know what I mean? And then in the world, they knew I wasn't worldly anymore. So they go, well, you're not the same guy that would try to lead us into sin. Like, you're trying to lead us the other way. So I could feel the uncomfortability around them, and they felt it around me, so they wouldn't even call me for barbecues or anything like that anymore, because it was like, you're bringing in Jesus literally while they're trying to sin. They wanted to sin, so they stopped bringing me around. But I'm thankful for the separation, even the separation that the Lord was doing with the church, else I would have been linked to the church and accepted lukewarmness. The only difference, and I don't boast in myself, the only difference that I feel between myself and the people that were in the church is when I heard the sermons, I didn't go, wow, that pastor is awesome. He did a great word. I want to hear more of that pastor. I didn't think like that, even though it was a good word, you know what I mean, a lot of times that I used to hear. And I would, you know, obviously say, oh, I like this guy. But after a sermon, and when the pastor was preaching, I could literally see the words coming out of his mouth. And I knew these were the words of God, not the words of the pastor. And I would go and research. I believed the word that was spoken, and I would make sure that it was in the Bible, and I would put it deep in my heart. And anytime I ran into trouble, anytime I needed something, anytime that I wanted to prove that I was at all good in any way, I would say and pray to the Father, I want to please you, Father. Like, I always aim to please God. And that is how you stand firm in your faith. You stop wanting to please yourself. You stop wanting to please others. You say, to yourself. You make a covenant with yourself to make sure that everything that you do, you're doing it to please the Father. You get your heart in a state, in a mind state, where that is factual and it is no longer you trying to please yourself. The Holy Spirit will help you to orchestrate all of these separations yourself. You have a right to peace in God. And it is you that have the right to separate yourself as well. And the Lord will help you. Every time somebody makes a comment on something, you don't have to reply. Anytime a mocker and scoffer attempts to use their sinful, angry state to try to get you riled up so that way you can have bitterness and anger in your heart, you don't have to respond. You can walk away. You don't have to respond to everybody on the internet like I don't. Let the mocker and scoffer talk to themselves, because surely if they don't repent and go to hell, they're going to be talking to themselves a long time by themselves in hell, repeating these things in their mind that they wish they would have never said. So don't take part in it. Just separate yourself. Call your ground of where you stand and stand in it, because it is your right. They have a right that they continue to use where they can cuss and tell you about their nasty stories and stuff at work and stuff. Why is it that they have the right to tell you about their nasty, sinful self, but you don't have the right to talk about your holy and righteous self? Always think about that. Just because they can say it to you, you have the right to say it back. You know what I mean? So you can either stand in what you want to say back or choose to not hear their sinful mouths. Choose to not let your family member in that keeps this guy that keeps putting on makeup in the house. Tell him, say, look, if you want to come to my house, like, I get it. You know what I mean? That you're the LBTG. I get all that. But in this house, this is a holy house. You know what I mean? So you can't come in my house and wear makeup. You're going to come to my house and you're going to be Billy that you were born as. And you're going to come in and you ain't bringing no boyfriend or nothing like that in my house. I love you. I want you to turn away from that. You know how God feels about that. But if you're going to come in my house, you're going to come in my house as who you were before you made this transition. And this is the kind of stance that you have to make. And if they will not do that, then you have to keep separate. I don't care if you got a grandkid with them. I don't care what it is. You know what I mean? But you need to stand your ground. And if you do not stand your ground, you know what I mean? Then you are denying the Lord. And if you deny the Lord, he will deny you in front of the Father. Do not fall in that trap that the wicked of this world and in the heavens continue to try to lock Christians in. They want to make you feel guilty. You know what I mean? About standing your ground. But we are not called to feel guilty about the truth. We are called to live in the truth and be the truth to these people, because we are at the end, and you demonstrating truth in your life by standing firm is what can save their souls later on after they get left behind. Let's continue. Let's get to the Bible verse of the day. This is 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 through 20. 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 through 20. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. You are no longer your own. Everything was made for him and by him, and he bought you back at Calvary. So you have to act like that and remember like that. You can't even make decisions on yourself if you want to bring somebody that is sinning in your house to sin. For you are God's himself now. He owns you. So you need to have that mentality for every move that you make, that you are not operating in yourself, else he will cut you off and separate you from the vine if you continue to behave like he's not yours. Like you're not his, excuse me. Okay, so big day today. Closing day is Tu B'Av, and we are entering in the Sabbath. So very serious day. Expect a high event to occur today or this weekend, but definitely today is a high marker day. And then once we get through the weekend, we'll talk about more things that are coming up with the NOAA timelines before September, as the next ones that we are getting to is the release of the raven and then the doves. And the raven definitely can symbolize the release of Satan or the Antichrist. God bless you and yours. Shalom. Love y'all. Jesus Christ surely loves you dearly. Have a good one. Later.
Look at you, kid. You're growing up quick. And I can't seem to tell you to slow. But there'll soon come a day and it scares me to death. When you tell me you're ready to go. No, you're quick as a whip, with your hands on your hips, only eyes that could rival your mom's. And so proudly I'll watch you make the world better off. So my prayer is wherever you go. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind blow airily. May the sun shine on your face. While the rain falls on your fields, may the world lie down before you. May you be all you can be. But may all those roads you roam wind home. And I'll visit your gifts, cause my folks did the same. And I'll pour your first glass of Bordeaux. Oh, watch me ruin your palate for anything else. So in your youth, you can't afford to get drunk. And oh, there's lips to be kissed, and there's ones to be missed. And you won't keep my 2 cents for long. So you'll make your mistakes like your mind died. Until one day you stumble on love. So may the Lord be kind to keep you. And may the devil fear your reach. May your pockets fill with gold. And yet your heart be void of greed. May the darkness bow before you. May you find the light. Tell you it's my turn to go. And that's cruel, I'll admit, but mourn for me quick. And look after those kids of your own. Oh, just make different mistakes than your mind, Dad. And make our ceiling look like your floor. So may the road rise up to meet you. And may your laughter fill the street. Children be as kind to you as you have been to me. And when you've had this world for all it's worth, and your grandkids let you leave,
Blessings to you all.